Man, I don't think they heard you. Why don't you tell them what your name is?
My name is Eazy-E. Yeah, this is true.
Dre's neighborhood friend, Eazy-E, came to the rescue.
When I left the Wrecking Crew, me and Eazy decided to create this label, Ruthless Records. He was going to basically fund it, and I was going to do all the creative work.
My homie Dre is a doctor, not a lawyer. Dope MC employer, own Ruthless, and that's my label.
How did Eazy have the funding? I'd rather not get into that.
He got the money like most kids get their money off the street.
A few, as you say, pharmaceutical sales.
Rumor has it you sold dope.
There was no time that I questioned where the money was coming from. All I cared about was getting in there, getting that studio time, and getting some records done.
In the future, Dre would be more careful before rushing into business deals. But for now, Dre and Eazy combined their talents to form a new group, NWA.
I'm expressing with my full capabilities, and now I'm living in correctional facilities.
They made waves for their graphic depiction of ghetto life.
NWA just says something that everybody always wanted to say, but didn't have the balls to say it, or didn't have a microphone.
Without NWA, you wouldn't have Marilyn Manson. You wouldn't have groups like Korn. You wouldn't have Eminem.
They were like the first group to ever say and so much on a record that it just made you want to go buy it.
One of those songs, F the Police, expressed what it was like to grow up in Compton.
The police coming straight from the underground. A young got it bad because I'm brown.
I had a couple of run-ins with cops. I was slammed on a few hoods when it wasn't really called for it.
Touching my car, looking for the product, thinking every is selling narcotics.
The FBI didn't like the message of the song and sent a letter of warning to the group, to little effect.
In our world, police physically touch you. You know, if these, you know, dudes want to just write a letter to try to scare us, man, that ain't gonna work.
Soon, music fans around the country were identifying with the Compton sound, a first for a California rap group.
At the time, it was all East Coast music.
You had Run DMC, they was talking about Queens, KRS, he was out talking about the South Bronx.
South Bronx, the South, South Bronx.
Everybody was out representing, and we just wanted to represent where we was from.
NWA definitely put Compton on the map, and boom, I have a career.
Chapter 2, in which Dre learns to separate art from life and death.
Tell him what you are.
I'm down when I'm stomping.
Now tell him where you're from.
Coming straight out of Compton, cause it- Ice Cube from the gang.
Yo,
with attitude, with a cord on. I got a s**t off, squeeze the ch**k, everybody's on hold on.
In the spring of 1989, NWA took their wild live show on the road. They brought the gritty glamour of gangster rap to the inner city and to the burbs.
I had no idea that suburbia America would be into what I did. I didn't really even know that white people listened to my music until the first NWA concert. We went on tour, and I think we were in Kentucky, and the audience was like 90% white. I was like, whoa.
So if you had a show in the front row, I'm gonna call you a dirty ass.
Like, okay, let's do our thing. I mean, straight up, I don't care. Just buy the ticket, man.
By the time he turned 24, sales of the Straight Outta Compton album and tour made Dre a wealthy man.
When the money was coming in, we was having fun, rolling, as you say.
It's definitely a good feeling to, you know, be able to go and buy some things without having to ask how much they cost. The first thing I bought when I started making money that meant anything was a new car.
Dre liked cars. He liked spending money.
I remember one time he told me, I'm gonna go get this watch. It's $10,000. And I was like, wow. Back then, it was like, wow, you gonna spend $10,000 on a watch?
Well, it's on and on and on and on. Yo, the beat don't stop until the break of dawn. Yo, every bitch I know they wanna get with me. The notorious D-R-E.
Yo, yo, yo.
All right, beat it.
Beat it.
This is part two of the Eazy and Dr. Dre Wildin' Wet Pool Party. As you can see, everybody's having a good time.
Dre's high rolling life on the road was filled with booze and booty.
It was pretty wild. I mean, matter of fact, almost too wild. Censor is gonna get us.
It was the first time that NWA had been out on tour, you know, and we were some young cats with a lot of money that all the girls like. Imagine the backstage area at that time. It was crazy.
The ladies loved Dre back in the day. You know, I'm sure they still love him now. They scream for him every night.
There was definitely a lot of groupies.
I seen Dre in rare form. Rare form.
Back then, I didn't care why girls wanted to be around me. As long as they wanted to be around, we would have our parties, invite everybody, and just chill. It really didn't matter to me what they wanted or what they were about. I just knew how I was going to respond to them and act when they got around, straight up.
In the early 90s, AIDS was making its mark on the party scene, but the group felt untouchable.
I mean, myself, I love having sex.
I don't know anybody that's gotten AIDS yet. But I don't want to know nobody that catch AIDS.
We were just about partying and, you know, let's hurry up and get to the next city and see what's there.
The fun came to an abrupt end when Dre got an urgent message from home.
We had to stop the tour bus because I was getting 911 pages from home, and that's something that I never get.
We stopped at a truck stop.
They went into a supermarket and called from a payphone, and that's when I was told. They just said, my brother is dead, you know? And I hung the phone up.
And Dre, you know, that kind of shook him, you know what I'm saying?
I'm on the front of the tour bus, and I hear, like, I thought it was laughing. So I go to the back of the bus, and Dre is, like, kneeled over on the couch. He look up, and I see tears in the eyes.
Sammy Sosa could have hit me in the back of the head with a bat, and it couldn't compare to the pain I felt at that moment. You know, it was just, crazy.
Tyree was the victim of a senseless act of violence.
He got into it with some guys. I mean, it's that simple in L.A.
We got into a tussle with some guy that was bigger than him.
He got pushed or something, hit his head on the concrete.
And it just, you know, he really didn't recover from that.
It was like something out of one of Dre's own records, but this was real and hit close to home.
It was definitely a major blow to our family.
I was at the house when they came and told us, man. I was young. I couldn't believe it. I just started crying, you know. You can't explain, you know, a pain like that.
Dre was overcome with grief, but he kept it to himself. No one could tell what was going on inside him.
We ain't never really talked about it, you know.
I still haven't talked to Dre about it. Dre is more of an internal dude, you know. You won't know what he feel about something, you know. He ain't gonna show you.
He didn't let that affect him. At least, you know, not in our presence. Maybe when he got back to his room, because that's something deep. But in front of the cameras and the crowds, he didn't let that affect him.
I just had to cope with it, you know? It was actually nothing else I can do but cope with it. You know what I'm saying? There's nothing that I could do to bring him back, you know? I just had to deal with it and move on.
This one is for my brother, Tyree, R.I.P.
10 years later, Dre journeyed to a place where he could express his feelings about his brother's death. On The Message, a track he included on 2001, he shared his pain out loud.
Through the music, Dre had to express on this album right here. You know, it must have been getting to him.
I never really wanted to get that personal on record, and that track was it. It just talked to me. It was like, okay, this is the one right here.
I'm feeling like my whole world is blinded, wondering why, crying, pouring out my heart, pouring out liquor behind it.
Dre's family learned a life lesson on the day Tyree died.
I think it just made the whole family, you know, realize that, you know, when you walk out the door today, you know, it's like you want to say I love you, you know what I'm saying, just in case something happened.
But that didn't really sink in until later. First, Dre had to take care of an urgent business matter. Soon after he rejoined the NWA tour, Ice Cube abruptly left the group.
Cube left NWA because of financial reasons.
Well, I just felt like for what I was contributing to the group, when, you know, the money came in, I wasn't paid right. What you gonna do? You know, it's either you stay there, you f***ed out your money, or you just be like, yo, I'm out of here.
A crack appeared in Dre's cool demeanor. He was angry his friend was putting money before music.
When Cube left the group, I was definitely pissed off, you know, because I didn't understand at the time, you know, how you could leave our group. We were like this at the time. We're all boys. We're cool. How could you leave our group? You know, let's sit down and work it out.
But it could not be worked out. Ice Cube had never signed a contract with NWA and was free to leave. For the first time in Dre's life, his problems stemmed from having money, not needing it.
As hard as you work for your money, there's 100 people out there working just as hard to get it from you, straight up.
A lot of times when we make it as rappers, we get money for the first time and we mishandle it. And we get bad accountants who don't
account to us and, you know, give us royalty statements or show us things. So we get, you know, molested because we're boys in the game.
We had no business skills, none. You know, that was where Dre learned everything right there.
Dre decided that Cube was right, that Jerry Heller, the man Eazy-E brought in to manage NWA's money, was not paying Dre what Dre thought he was owed.
I actually stepped to Eric and I said, look, man, it's either me or him. One of us got to go, you know? It's like if he goes, we can continue doing what we got to do. He chose to keep the manager, so I had to leave.
Eazy-E, you're dropping like a brick, boy. See ya.
Eazy-E was not pleased.
We staying sucker free in 93, so we don't deal with Dre. Dre ain't got no love.
No love?
No love whatsoever.
The two former buddies spent years dissing each other.
All of a sudden, Dr. Dre is the G thing, but on his own album covers, he was a she thing.
He is a puppet on a string doing what somebody told him to do. He's gonna fail in the long run, you know, because he has no talent.
It went on a long time, and E, it hurt. You could tell he didn't like, you know what I'm saying? He didn't like it.
Today, Dre laughs it off as all part of the game.
It wasn't me being angry. It was just funny to me, you know what I'm saying? I just thought it was a funny thing to do.
Just sign your life, I mean your name on the contract.
Dre wasn't laughing in 1995, though, when Eric Wright, the infamous Eazy-E, made a shocking announcement.
Actually, when I found out that Eric was sick, it was when he went into the hospital.
Nobody knew. None of us knew. You know, he just looked regular, you know what I mean?
I'm here to read a statement that was prepared by Eazy for the world. I got thousands and thousands of young fans that have to learn about what's real when it comes to AIDS.
I heard it was like all kind of people up at the hospital, like they made it into a circus, like fools trying to shop demos. You know, they wasn't even mourning him. They was up there trying to see who up there, you know, it was hoes up there trying to see what they could get, what kind of money they could get.
Put off by the circus-like atmosphere at the hospital, Dre avoided visiting Eazy. When he finally arrived, it was too late.
When I went to see him, he was unconscious, you know, so I didn't get a chance to talk to him at the hospital. He was there on life support, and it was like a scary, scary sight. I got to say goodbye to him, but he didn't get to say goodbye back.
What's the difference between me and you? But it wasn't too late to let the world know what he had learned. Like he did for his brother on 2001, Dre once again said his goodbyes out loud, paying public tribute to his fallen comrade.
Sometimes the business end of this shit can turn your friends against you. But I'll never forget the shit you've been through. And I'ma do whatever it takes to convince you. Cause you might die, and Eazy, I'm still with you. The people, I miss you, and that's just being real with you.
Next stop on the journey, Dre joins up with a notorious new business partner. And Death Row shows the world there ain't nothing like a gangster party.
Dre don't get as high.
Incredible shit I've ever heard.
Bow, wow, wow, yippee-yo, yippee-yay. Doggy dogs definitely in the house.
Bow, wow, wow, yippee-yo, yippee-yay. Death Row's definitely in the house.
It took me a minute to catch on.
I heard it once. I was like, oh, it's cool. And then one day, you know, it's like all Dre records, you know, one day it just got you and you listening to it all the time.
We just called each other up like, man, do you hear this?
Do you hear this?
Ever since then, man, I was a believer.
If you listen sonically to that album and the way that those beats and everything is produced and edited together, I mean, it's amazing. It's a masterpiece.
I heard a lot of hip-hop records, but I never heard production come through the speakers like that in that genre.
For a while, I think everybody was believing that if it's a hip-hop record, it has to sound dirty and it has to sound gritty. I beg to differ, you know. I feel like you can do it, make it sound as clean as a Michael Jackson album, and still be aggressive and still give you that same feeling.
It sounded good. It made you feel good.
Dre got that feeling by doing most of the production work himself.
You see him on the drum machine, he'd get off the drum machine, jump on the keyboard. You see him off the keyboard, he's sitting at the board, EQing on the board.
I'm not a control freak at all, you know? I just like it my way.
He doesn't sing, but he knows how to tell them how he wants them to sing it.
I'm stranded on Death Row.
when I was like, I'm not sagging, but I'm blue flagging, but you don't want to see the D-O-double-G. He made me do it like that tone. I wanted to do it in another tone, and I didn't understand why, but then when it finally came out, I was like, okay, dokie. I'm not sagging, but I'm just sagging, but you don't want to see the D-O-double-G. It made me sound like I could sing, you know what I mean? Notes, things that I don't know about.
It's like this and like that and like this and it's like that and like this and like that and it's like this and we ain't got no love for those.
So just chill till the next episode.
One of my favorite joints on the Chronic was Nothing But a G Thing.
Come on, people still singing that today, you know? They gonna sing it 20 years from now. They gonna say 1, 2, 3 and 10 to 4. Snoop Doggy Dogg and Dr. Dre is at your door.
Ready to make an entrance, so back on up.
Before I have to pull the strap off the cut.
Cause ain't nothing but a G-bang, baby. Too loped out G, so we crazy.
It's classic.
Yeah, that's what they tell me. Everybody tells me that, you know, that album is classic. I think I can do better.
But in 1992, no one could do better. And G-Thang rose to the top of the pop charts. Soon, Death Row artists were overtaking pop and metal, both on the charts and in the public eye, as the new bad boys of music.
If you open your mouth against me, I will get you. No matter how much time they give me, believe me, I will be free and you will see me. So watch your mouth.
Yeah, we were the bad boys of music and still are. Straight up. That's just the type of music that we like.
A lot of people didn't like the music or the messages behind it.
Negative rap is not all right. Negative rap is not all right.
A young black man should not be allowed to call a woman a female dog. It should not be tolerated.
But Dre saw his records as party soundtracks, not message music.
I don't try to express myself with music. I don't really take it like that serious, you know. I'm not like, you know, Sinead O'Connor or something like that, who, in my opinion, takes everything way too serious. I just go in the studio and try to make something that's gonna get everybody in the studio's head moving. Something that you can pop in your dash in your car and make you drive faster.
But the gangster rap backlash was in full swing. And in 1995, Dre's record label caved in to the pressure.
When Time Warner dropped Death Row, it bothered me a little bit because it's kind of hard to see something that you work so hard on building just, you know, start to crumble.
What hurt Dre more was the criticism he was getting from black leaders.
Snoop Doggy Doo-Doo, Doggy, whatever his name is, calling women bitches, calling women hoes. Little boy can't even spell hoe.
Yeah, that bothered me when prominent black people were protesting the music, because we employ, I don't know how many black people that would probably be out doing dirt if they didn't have these jobs. I don't think they were getting the big picture.
That's what friends are for.
But Death Row soon had a new investor, and Dre and his label mates went right back to raking in the cash.
Hey, next year Death Row gonna start printing our own money.
Definitely great to be at a black-owned company and, you know, making a lot of money, just living that life that everybody dreams to live.
Chapter 4, in which Dre learns that peace of mind is worth a pound of gold.
In the early 90s, Dr. Dre firmly established himself as the most influential record producer of his generation.
With a producer who can rap and control the maestro at the same time with the dope rhyme that I kick. You know and I know I feel some old funky shit.
I think Dre is the most impactful record producer in history. There were greats like Phil Spector and Sam Phillips. You cannot say that any one have had more impact musically and socially as Dr. Dre.
Whatever I do, I'm gonna do it to the fullest. Man, I'm gonna be the best at it, or I'm gonna die trying.
And he almost did. In a series of misadventures beginning with the 1992 fire, he and his house guests escaped just in the nick of time.
We was going to Dre's house for a barbecue, and boy, did we get a barbecue.
The damn house burned down.
It was like flames 50 feet in the air.
The fire did nothing to chill the nonstop partying and out-of-control behavior enjoyed by Dre and his posse.
A lot of fighting. People get crazy, you know, maybe have a 40 too much. But it wasn't nothing like no shooting, no cutting, just pretty much like bar brawl type stuff.
All of which soon led to Dre's next brush with death in 1992.
One of the homegirls that was with the camp was being disrespected by some gentlemen, and Dre wasn't having it.
Fight broke out.
and somebody pulled out a gun.
Shots rung out.
Dre got shot.
I'm hit. That's it.
Dre was like, damn, my legs is burning.
Can you imagine getting shot with a 9mm hollow point bullet?
And he like, ah.
That shit hurts. For real.
They called the ambulance. When they came, they cut his pants off. And he had like about $2,000 in his pocket. And me and Warren G picked it up. And we brought it back to the hospital. When we could have, took the two G's because we was not doing well at the time and been splurged up.
Dre actually received a bigger gift that day.
That was like, in my opinion, a straight up wake up call. You know, it's like, slow down, get up out those streets.
Getting thrown in jail was another wake up call for Dre.
With my legal troubles, I was just young and stupid. I look back on it like, what was I doing?
The first big slip-up occurred in 1991, when Dre was arrested for assaulting TV host Dee Barnes, who had just allowed Ice Cube to insult N.W.A. on her show, Pump It Up.
Before I knew it, he grabbed me by my hair, picked me up, and started slamming me into a brick wall. Meanwhile, I'm all disoriented, and I'm like, you know, oh, man, I can't believe Dre is doing this to me.
Later convicted on additional assault charges, Dre was hit with fines, probation, and in May of 1992, a 60-day house arrest.
House arrest is where you're pretty much in jail, but you're in your house, and they put this little device around your ankle, and you can't be more than 100 feet away from your telephone. I thought it was gonna be cool, you know? I'd stay in the house, all I gotta do is have parties all the time. I got my studio here, I can work, I can party. But after a while, those walls start closing in on you, and it's like, yeah. You gotta get up out of here, you know? It does become jail.
Welcome to death row.
The turning point came in 94 when Dre took his $200,000 Ferrari out for a high-speed joyride. Dr. Dre was pulled over for doing 90 and for failing an alcohol test. In violation of his probation, he was sentenced to 8 months in jail. The man who was always in control was losing his grip on life.
At times like that, I just have to step out of myself and look at myself and ask a question, you know, like, what are you doing? And what are you gonna do? Fortunately, I had an answer, and it was a good one. Get your together.
Spending that time in jail really cleared Dre's head on what life is about. You know, he realized that he wasn't invincible. No matter how many records he sell, no matter how much money he got.
Dre checked his drinking.
I never make an important decision when I've had anything to drink. That's strictly for partying.
And got his life together.
All in all, I think it was a blessing in disguise, straight up.
Meanwhile, his buddy Snoop was having his own legal troubles. Snoop was tried.
We, the jury, in above entitled action, find a defendant not guilty of the crime.
And acquitted for murder in 1996. While Dre was laying low, trying to make sense out of what was happening to his record company.
They blew up so fast. All that happened, like, in 2 years. There was a lot of money. They was doing their thing.
Now it's 95, and they clock me and watch me diamond shining, looking like a Rob Liberace.
I mean, when you give money to a group of people that never dealt with money, it's almost like throwing steaks to lions that never had steak before.
Death Row was, in fact, a lion's den with a well-earned gangster rep.
Once again, the mighty Death Row organization committing mass murder.
There were rumors that the company's employees, many of whom were former gang members, used violence and intimidation as an everyday way of doing business.
Yeah, the safety hazard hanging around the Death Row environment.
I would say a good one time a week you see somebody get their ass whooped.
It was a pressure cooker. It could have just went at any time.
And I've never been to Death Row Studios without my gun. Never knew what to expect.
By all accounts, Dre kept his focus on the music and distanced himself from the violence said to be happening frequently behind the scenes.
You know, ass whoopings was going. Dre didn't want to be a part of that. Dre worked way over here somewhere with his own soft little crew doing his own little thing. He didn't want to be a part of that.
But as co-owner and president of the company, Dre was accountable whether he liked it or not. And after doing some hard thinking in prison, Dre determined that he didn't like where Death Row was going.
You put out negative energy, it's going to come back to you, period. Live by the gun, die by the gun.
Dre concluded that at Death Row, creative control and financial freedom came at too great a cost, his conscience and his peace of mind.
It just stopped being fun, and this whole thing is supposed to be fun. That's what I've always dreamed about doing, doing something that I can have fun at and make money at it, make a living.
What you gonna do when you grow up and have to face responsibility?
I had to get up and out.
In March of 1996, he left the label, telling his closest friends first in the privacy of his home.
I had, like, everybody that I wanted to continue to be a part of my life come to my house.
And he goes, I just want everybody to know that I'm leaving Death Row. The whole room was like, what?
When Dre left, I was shocked.
That was a big surprise.
Everybody was pretty happy.
I went into a state of panic.
It wasn't a sad face in that house.
It was a depressing period for me because the public really didn't want to hear me without Dre because they were so used to hearing me with Dre.
Death Row ain't without Dr. Dre.
Dre faced the tough task of extricating himself from his business partnership with Suge, which he did at a financial loss.
When you separate yourself from somebody in this business, it's almost like a divorce.
If Dre choose to go ahead and start a new production company, yeah, my blessing. So be it. So be it, but Dre didn't get zero from Death Row to go move forward.
When it came to money, Dr. Dre had taken a long journey, longer than just his trip out of the ghetto. He had come from having no money to having it all, from learning how to build on what he earned to knowing when it was time to take his money and walk away.
I think the creative freedom and the room to breathe and to call your own shots is more important than money. You know, Dre left Death Row, and many people say, well, he's leaving with nothing. He left with everything.
I didn't leave broke, you know what I'm saying? I did leave with money. I didn't leave with what I was supposed to, but I left with something that was a lot more valuable, peace of mind. And you can't put a dollar sign on that.
On the final journey stop, Dre takes control of his life.
My motivation to keep going is strictly this. I cannot let you win if you're trying to stop me at what I'm trying to do. That show Cops that comes on TV really made me realize that we do need police in a major way, straight up.
He also downsized his crew to a few close associates.
The people you surround yourself with can be either the rise or the fall of your career. You have to surround yourself with positive people that have your best interests at heart.
And when he launched his new record company, Aftermath Entertainment, he did it on his own.
Right now, I feel like I'm on top of the world because it's just me. There's no partnerships. If it fails, it's on me. If it works, it's on me. And I couldn't feel better.
His first release was a commercially disappointing 96 Aftermath album on which he tried to retreat from the negativity of gangster rap.
Getting out of Death Row, I was trying to distance myself from that type of music for a while. That's why I made the song Been There, Done That.
I've been there, done that. You got guns, yo, I got straps. On the planet Earth, talk that hard wood, cause that's all they work.
The critics and fans weren't buying it though, and Dre was bummed.
He really wasn't showing his depression, but you gotta fall down in order to get up. And you know, the hard fall made for a tough get up.
I just wanted to try something different for a minute, and it wasn't working for me. I have to do what I know how to do, and do what I do best. And that's just hardcore hip hop.
One of the ways Dre found his way home, back to hardcore hip hop, was through an unlikely protege he found on a demo tape.
Hi, my name is what? My name is what? My name is Zadie.
Apparently, he didn't know that I was white.
It's like, what? That is crazy.
The two studio perfectionists fed off each other. Dre gave Eminem someone to impress.
My whole intention on the Slim Shady LP was to get a reaction from Dre.
Mr. Dre, Mr. NWA, Mr. AK, coming straight out of Compton, y'all better make way.
What you say?
Dre thinks it's funny.
I have to let every artist be them. You know what I'm saying? I can't censor anything that they're gonna say. If there was somebody censoring me when I started, I probably wouldn't be here today.
Eminem took it a step further on his follow-up album.
I think I killed Dre twice on this record.
And Dr. Dre said, nothing, you idiots. Dr. Dre's dead. He's locked in my basement.
The first time I killed Dre on the record, it was cool. Second time, he was like, hey, I ain't gonna be dying no more on these records.
I'll kill you, you little...
temper, temper.
What Eminem gave Dre was inspiration to go hardcore again. But first, he needed one more approval.
He calls no shots at home. He just lives there. At home, he's Pop. You know, he's not Dr. Dre, he's Pop.
When Dre met Nicole back in 1994, he was still living the Playboy hip-hop lifestyle.
I wasn't out looking for love or looking for the right person or anything like that. It just happened.
We met at a nightclub in L.A. I was just walking by, and someone did a little pinch on my arm. And he just stood there and looked at me with this cocky look on his face and asked me for my phone number. I gave him the craziest look and said, no.
But Dre pursued, and they got married in Hawaii in 1996.
Boom, there you have it.
Marriage was a big change for Dre.
Children change your life. And to see him evolve into a family person, it's beautiful.
Before, we used to be like, hell yeah, we off stage, we going to the after party, let's go bust us some hoes, and we don't even think like that no more.
But with family responsibilities came a guilty conscience. Could Dre rock the hard stuff and still respect his wife?
I just got married, and I really was feeling funny about saying bitch and hoe and things of that nature.
Bitches ain't shit, but hoes and tricks.
Ironically, it was Nicole who encouraged him to return to his roots.
It's an image. It's a job. He was doing some stuff, and I was like, it was good, but it wasn't Dre.
She kind of motivated me into going back to doing what I do.
Maybe you should, you know, start saying all that crazy stuff again.
So I'm like, okay.
Of course, she wasn't about letting him bring the gangster persona home with him.
How would she react if I called her a whore, bitch? I couldn't even, like, picture myself doing that straight up at all.
Never.
Never.
Dre soon set about making 2001. He knew he had something to prove.
There was so much talk going on that, you know, I didn't have it anymore and I couldn't produce a hit record anymore.
Y'all better listen up closely. All you said that I turned pop or the firm flop. Y'all are the reason that Dre ain't been getting no sleep. So, y'all.
You know, a lot of people criticize Dr. Dre and try to, you know, close his casket.
I definitely went in the studio with Let Me Prove Everybody Wrong in mind, and I think I succeeded.
What's up, New York? Guess who's back?
2001 was released in November 1999 and has since sold more than 5.5 million copies. The critics have been silent.
They want to know if you still got it. They say rap's changed. They want to know how I feel about it.
You ain't up on things.
Dr. Dre is the name on my head of my game. Still the beast bang, still doing my thing. Since I left, ain't too much change.
Last summer, Dre took his crew out on the Up and Smoke tour. The most successful hip-hop tour ever.
It's D-R-E. You know I'm mobbing with the D-O-double-G. Straight off the streets of CBC.
Dre get love everywhere we go, man. Dre get smiles and handshakes, man. He also get like a lot of family members he never met, man.
On tour, everyone is part of the family. Dre has left the fear and intimidation of Death Row days behind him.
We do a prayer every night out here on tour. You know, everybody hug, and we get into a circle together, and we pray that we all stay safe together as a family.
And even though his own brother Tyree is very much with him.
Always with me. That's my little bird right here, you know what I'm saying?
Dre serves as a brother and mentor to many of his closest friends.
Dre is kind of like a big brother to me.
Sometimes I feel like a little brother to him.
I've been in the business a lot longer than they have, so I think I have a lot of positive advice to offer to them. I know for a fact there's a lot of people out there that I inspire and I motivate, and I love that.
Dr. Dre is convinced that hardcore hip-hop is his calling, maybe even a spiritual quest.
I do believe life is a journey. I do believe everybody was put on this planet for a purpose. I think the reason that I was put here was to entertain people with my music.
One of his several mottos is, it's greater later. And I never looked at things like that until I met him. And it's so true. As the years go by, it's greater.
Dre has learned from his journey and now enjoys all the money he wants and peace of mind. He is honored for his past and looks forward to the future.
I think me and Dr. Dre gonna be like, who was it, Walter Matthau and Jack Lemmon? They grew old together, didn't they?
I can definitely picture me and Snoop being like 50 and 60 years old, kicking it.
I see me with gray braids and us in a wheelchair with rims on the wheelchair, rolling down the street, smoking, sipping on Hen and juice.
That's a nice goal. I think I'm gonna shoot for that.
That's what me and Dre gonna be doing in the year 2040 at the Rap Hall of Fame. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for rap pioneers, Dr. Dre and Snoop Doggy Dogg in their 50th anniversary of Still a G Thing. Come out there with my cane. One, two, three, into the phone. Oh, hell, Dre, they know it.